Hi, I'm Rachel Frick. I'm the Executive Director of the Research Library Partnership, which is a unit within the larger OCLC Research and Membership Division. And I'm here to talk to you today about what's happening in the Membership and Research Division and just give you an overview of some news and upcoming events, but then we'll hand it off to our program officers, our esteemed folks sitting here to my right, who will give you some more information about the work that they've been delving into for the past few months. I am new to OCLC, and I'm really excited to be part of the Membership and Research Division because it's great to be part of an organization whose main purpose is to scale and accelerate library learning and innovation. And we do this in the Membership and Research Division in three ways. We like to engage our members as advocates who participate in effective in the cooperative, and as well as activate communities of practice, and we generate knowledge, evidence, and models in order to help our librarians feel confident in positioning their organizations to be successful. So briefly in the news, how many went to the session about ACRL's strategic agenda that OCLC is helping develop? A few of you? Great. Lynn Conaway is working on this to develop an action-based strategic agenda about how libraries contribute to student learning. So we're really excited to be part of that with ACRL. We've also announced our 2017 IFLA Fellows. And in 2016, how many people participated in a member forum last year? Hands? It was great. We were really happy with the results of that. That was led under Irene Hoffman. We had over 1,100 attendees across the United States at 13 events. We even had one event in the UK. Our community center, which was launched in 2015, has grown to over 9,000 members. And we have relaunched what we've called the Distinguished Seminar Series. How many people know about the Distinguished Seminar Series? A few folks. Well, this was started way back in 1978, and the idea was to bring expertise from the library community into Dublin to help share their knowledge and wisdom with the OCLC staff so they can get a better idea of the challenges facing our members. So we started this off. Our first speaker for this series has been Trevor Dawes, and throughout 2017, we'll be focusing on issues around diversity, inclusion, and equity. So keep your eye out for new topics. Even though the primary focus is to educate OCLC staff, we do record these and have them available for everybody to view. The program that I lead, the Research Library Partnership, we're going to be kicking off our first quarter activities by having a meeting prior to the RLUK meeting that's going to be happening at the British Library in March. We're going to have a short meeting on the 8th, and our focus is going to be how our libraries present their organizations and their collections on the web. And we're really happy to have Kenning Arlich from Montana State University to be contributing to our program. So if you haven't signed up or you want to attend or want more information, please go to our website under events. So new projects, and I like to say a passive inquiry that we're developing underneath the Research Library Partnership and in our research division at large, are the following. I'm just going to give you a sneak preview so you can see what we're going to be up to for 2017. Rebecca Bryant, she's one of our newest program officers. She's exploring how libraries are working in research data management as well as research information management system. One of her first publications under this path of inquiry is going to be a series of case studies about research data management and capacity. And it's actually a really nice global in scope perspective, and she's pulling these case studies from Edinburgh, Australia, and elsewhere in the United States. How many people have heard about the Web Archiving Metadata Work Group being led by Jackie Dooley? A few of you? Great. This activity, they've been working really hard for several months, and they're going to be publishing three studies this year. The first one is going to be concentrating on web archiving tools, and that should be out late the first quarter, so keep an eye out on that. But I'm really excited to talk to you about our first publication of 2017, which is Advancing the National Digital Platform, the State of Digitization in U.S. Public and State Libraries. This survey was a result of a very generous grant from the Institute of Museum and Library Services, and we did the survey in partnership with COSLA, DPLA, and two divisions of ALA, ELEX and PLA. The goal of the survey was to understand and get a gauge on the readiness and participation of public libraries in a national digital platform, specifically on digital collections and sharing those at a national scale. Just some quick highlights from that study. We were happy, I think we had over 700 participants from public libraries, and we had 47 state libraries contribute to this survey, which I think is a really good participation rate. I'm gonna check my notes. Over 92% of public libraries stated that they had locally significant, unique physical collections, but only 38% of those libraries had engaged in digitization activities in the last 3 years. And some of the common barriers that they said that were stated and reasons why they weren't participating, that they had identified insufficient staff and training expertise as a barrier to these digitization efforts. So we've identified some training opportunities, some things around imaging best practices, copyright risk assessment, as well as metadata best practices are seen as potential and impactful areas for training in these for public libraries. But what I think is great about this study, it's a meeting point for us to talk about how to extend our expertise and help our public libraries participate in these national platforms. So this study is available underneath our reports page. It's actually going to be available, if not later today, tomorrow for download. But what also is really interesting, this is the first time we're going to be releasing the data set that informed the publication for folks to download as well, so they can also do, you can do your independent analysis on that data set. So we're very happy to bring this to you and thankful for the support of IMLS. Before I hand things off to our speakers today, since I am new and been in this position for about 4 months, I just wanted to briefly talk about the Research Library Partnership. How many folks here are members of the Research Library Partnership? Great. So really quickly, we're going to be working this year to actively engage our partners and demonstrate how this program is a platform for people to get closer to the OCLC research process and be able to participate and help us develop what we would call strategic agendas around specific areas in order to inform practice, as well as identify what we would say knowledge gaps or opportunities for OCLC to contribute or dive deeper into a research activity. We feel that we're a trusted resource to help our libraries understand our research in context, not just our research, but also I'm sure you know there's so many research studies or things we need to read. So I feel like the RLP can help you contextualize that and synthesize that, and so you can take those key messages back home and be able to take action on the many different research reports that are out there. And of course, I think one of the most valuable assets of this program are our staff, because we have areas of expertise that extend quite the spectrum, especially around metadata and knowledge work, distinctive or what people might call special collections, and we're expanding this area around research data management, and of course the iconic work from Constance Malpas and Brian Lavoie around collective collections. So that's about it for me. I'm really your MC today and host. So I'm going to hand it off to the meat of the program today. And we're going to start off with Roy Tennant, who's going to talk about data design for discovery. And then Dennis is going to take the baton from there and give you some more details about the ILL cost calculator. And then Sharon's batting cleanup, and she's going to be talking about our work around Wikipedia and public libraries. So without further ado, Roy.
Thanks, Rachel. Okay, I'll just start with a few introductory remarks. First, this is the research view of linked data. So although we have various experiments and prototypes, I would say on the production side, we don't yet have any products or services to offer you, and I can't say anything about what those might be. So this is the research view. Now, I want to explain what I mean by data design for discovery. And usually, I do this presentation, I have a good bit of time to explain where I think we are in the metadata world vis-a-vis linked data. But I don't have that time today, so I just want to briefly say that lately I've been advocating a particular viewpoint, and that is that I believe that MARC has been developed primarily as metadata design for description. That is, to describe an object in hand and provide the ability to distinguish it from a different object that might be similar. So it really serves that purpose, and it serves it fairly well. The problem is, when we get to the linked data world, is we really need to design data for discovery. And that's a very different role and ability. So it becomes difficult then to take data that was designed for description and move it into a discovery world. So that's some of the challenges that we face in this area. Some of the most recent work is my colleague Karen Smith Yoshimura. Wave to the nice people, Karen. recently published this 2015 International Linked Data Survey, which was a follow-on from the previous survey. I just want to briefly touch some of the highlights of this. 71 institutions responded, which is a tremendous response rate, and you can see the breakdowns there. No surprise, most of the responses came from academic libraries and national libraries. They're the ones who are primarily really involved in this. Some of the metadata that they published as linked data, again, no big surprise, descriptive metadata, bibliographic data, and authority files were the primary areas in which they were publishing linked data. Although you can see that there were some other areas in which they published as well. Something I thought was very interesting was out of the top 10 sources that were used by these institutions, OCLC has three of them. So you can see that VAF is widely used out there in the community, and then also FAST and WorldCat.org. If you want to know more about this, Karen has blogged about it. She also has an article in DLib magazine. So go and check those out for more information. There's a very rich set of questions that were asked. So it's a pretty deep study of the institutions and what they're doing with linked data. So in general, we're doing a couple big things. We're solving problems and moving us to a linked data future in a variety of ways. First of all, we're modeling library data. And we do this within OCLC using schema.org, which is the RDF format that search engines know and understand. So when we put our linked data out there on WorldCat.org, the search engines can swoop in and just gather this data and understand it natively and not have to try to interpret it from some library standard. We're also creating a linked data process, and I'm not going to go through this in detail, but in general, what it means is taking the existing MARC records, enriching those records in various ways, mapping them to schema.org, converting it to RDF triples, applying various headings and IDs to that data, so enriching it with URIs that can be resolved, and then sticking it out there on WorldCat.org and at other locations as well. So when we publish it to WorldCat.org, any record in WorldCat, if you go to it, such as this one right here, if you scroll down, there will be a linked data tab that you can open, which will show you the linked data. This is, of course, on the web page and being scraped by the crawlers. But you can also view it and take a look at exactly how we have modeled the data and the various URIs that we put in there that can be resolved. So in general, we've advanced this concept of the work, which is a higher level concept. It comes from Ferber principles. So we're trying to associate various manifestations of an item with one overarching record. And that's, if you go here, you can actually travel to a work level record. We're also exploring ways to use the linked data, which I think is some of the most interesting things that we're doing right now. This is an example of an experiment using something called Entity.js. It is built on JavaScript. And what this does is, if you put in a search, and in this case, we start putting Abraham Lincoln, then you can come to this page for Abraham Lincoln and find information about Abraham Lincoln, which is pulled from Wikipedia, the photo, which is pulled from Wikipedia, related works, which is coming from WorldCat. If you go on down, you'll see subject headings and so forth. And those links are resolvable in many cases. So you'll be able to just travel down the linked data road, if you will, into various areas. So this is actually trying to demonstrate the power of linked data and what it provides us in terms of discovery and use. We're also working to make linked data solve the translation problem, which is to make it easier for users to locate the appropriate translation of a work. So here's an example of a work that was originally authored in Chinese, and it has these various translations, which we then link to, and then the translations themselves link back to that original work. So we're seeing the linked data is a really vital way to provide this additional functionality that is presently very difficult to do within our systems today. We're also working to bring library authority control to the web by working with Wikipedia. For a while, we had a Wikipedian in residence who actually wrote a bot to go in and put identifiers into Wikipedia pages. So we now have a lot of these links to VAF and WorldCat and other of our data sources now in Wikipedia. We're also helping to ease the transition here into linked data in various ways. So we're collaborating with the Library of Congress on BibFrame. I was just speaking at the LC BibFrame update yesterday morning about some of that work. So we talk to them all the time, and we're trying to really figure out where the future's going and how to get all of us there the easiest way we can. We're of course also working with the web itself by publishing our linked data in a form that it can understand, and also expanding the definitions within schema.org in order to enable us to describe more data elements within the schema.org vocabulary. We're also working with the Program for Cooperative Cataloging. We have representation on the Work Task Force as well as the URI Task Force. The Work Task Force is trying to figure out that this concept of work, because people define it in various different ways, and we have to try to find some common definitions. So they're looking at those different definitions and seeing how they're the same or different. What are the use cases for this concept and so forth. The URI Task Force is looking for ways to insert URIs into the existing MARC records today so that when we get to translating it to linked data, they'll already be there and we can just use them instead of having to try to resolve them at that point. And then the work of both of those task forces kind of overlap in terms of how should the work URIs be represented in MARC records. And both of these groups are due to come up with some findings this year. We're also documenting our decisions. So I recommend to you this book by my colleagues, and it goes into quite some depth in terms of some of the decisions we're making around linked data and some of the work that we're doing around linked data. And this is also freely available as a download. So go out there and find that and find out more information about the kinds of things we're doing with linked data. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Roy. Hi, everybody. If you've been a regular at these OCLC research updates for a while, you've probably heard me talk about this before. And in fact, some of you could be forgiven for feeling like you could probably come up and talk about the project with some authority yourselves. But we're actually nearly finished with the first phase of the beta testing now. And I actually have data from two institutions, real data from two of the beta institutions. So there are some new things to report and some new sites to see. And as far as my question that's posed in the title here, what's in it for you? I'll circle back around to that at the end of the talk, and hopefully by then it'll be obvious what's in it for you. So for those of you who are not regulars and have not heard me talk about this before, some background. The ILO cost calculator is a long-running project, like several years now, where it started out where three members of OCLC Research Library Partnership institutions got together with me to fill in a gap. There's no current data available really about what it costs to share collections. In fact, most of the numbers that are quoted across the community right now, they're now about 15 years old. So we got together and decided, wouldn't it be great if we could build a tool that would, when we finished it, would end up functioning as a virtual real-time cost study. So that's what we set out to do, and it took us a while to get to the point where we had, kind of the design in place, and that happened about a year and a quarter ago. And since then, the top three were the three who helped me, by the way. I can't remember if I said that. But now all these beta testers, for about a year and a quarter, we've been working real hard on testing out the registration, the data gathering, and the data reporting functions. So the three original people and I spent a great deal of time on use cases, and we decided pretty early that our tool would need to do all of these things. Knowing your own unit costs and being able to compare them with others seemed really essential. And that's what the previous cost studies did. But we also wanted our tool to take a step further. We wanted to, if you could, by applying filters and taking them back off, we hope that when this thing's done, you'll be able to query the data and actually find out about what the potential financial impact might be for different decisions you can make about how you're running your unit. So for instance, if you automate a certain process, wouldn't it be interesting to know what the costs look like for folks who have automated that process? Or if you wanted to buy a high-end scanner, what impact would that have on your productivity? And if you want to implement a new service where you're delivering your own collections to your own patrons, what might the impact of that be? And this thing is going to, when it's done, it'll live freely on the web, and anybody who has access to the web can go have a look. And in fact, anyone can go when it's done and find out things like how many libraries have put their data in this thing, and what are the average costs per borrowed transaction or loan transaction across those libraries. If folks want to know more detailed things or more of a breakdown, like returnables, non-returnables, that kind of thing, you'll need to register and contribute your data, and then you can have a more detailed breakdown. Again, we've been beta testing for about 15 months now, and the beta testers have just gone through and considered hundreds of different issues about functionality, but they've also been working on some philosophical questions, including the ones you see here. A big one has always been about what should be counted and what shouldn't be counted. One we've grappled with recently was that idea of if you're delivering from your own collections to your own patrons, is that part of this and should it be? And what we finally came up with was, sure, if you want it to be, just say, yeah, I included this in my data, but we're going to keep that as a separate line of reporting. So it's because it's not really sharing with other libraries, but you may want to include it because sometimes the same staff do that. So again, you'll indicate if that's what you're doing. And when you make comparisons with others, you'll indicate if that's part of what you're comparing. What costs that folks can't come up with, what should we do about that? Each of the betas had at least one or two costs that they just couldn't come up with. So does that mean you can't play because you can't fill in the form to its conclusion? Would that be a good solution? No, that would not be a good solution. So what we finally decided to do was come up with a series of check boxes at the beginning. So if users put their data into this, you'll let us know what you're reporting, and more importantly, perhaps, what you're not reporting. And when you go to do the comparison functions with peer institutions, you'll only be comparing your data that you've included with the data they've included. So you're comparing apples to apples. And what we hope happens, if enough institutions put their data into this thing, that even those who can't really report everything, they'll get some benefit out of it and from others, because we hope the system will suggest to these folks, hey, that cost you couldn't report, remember that one thing? Libraries that are like you, according to your criteria that you've picked to describe yourself, they tend to have that particular cost that you couldn't report be X percent of their total cost. So they'll learn from others as well. So that's what we hope happens. And then as far as that last one, the confidential and sensitive costs, that's a really tricky question. And we spent a lot of time talking about what to do about that. And I think we've come up with a good solution. Don't know how well you can see that, so I'm going to tell you all about it. It's one thing you can clearly see from that one page about ILL systems. The tool that we're using to gather the data is really detailed, but that's only to help you figure out, have I got everything? Have I collected everything and included it? What's going to be reported back to me to be included in the tool are just high-level totals for each category of expense. We will never see this level of detail. And so a good example of that is the ILL systems that you use, the different automated systems you use to share your collections and to track requests. You could, I mean, originally when we thought of this, we thought you'd be listing each system that you use and what you actually paid for it. But some folks are, you know, a lot of public institutions, they don't care. All their salaries and everything, public knowledge, you can look them up on the web. But other folks are like, you know, we sign confidentiality agreements for some of this stuff. Even shippers, I think some folks who sign up with FedEx, they're not allowed to report what they're paying. It's confidential. So what we've decided to do is just report in major categories. And I don't know if you can see that very well, but for request for ILL systems, we made up three categories. Request movers, consortial borrowing, because we really had an interest in separating that out, and request managers. And I will say more about what those mean in a second. So now the tool, even on the private pages that only you will see, the default will be just, here's a mover, mover number one, mover number two. It's kind of like that Dr. Seuss story, thing number one, thing number two. And you can type over the actual names of the systems if you want to, or you can just keep a key where you know what mover one, number two is. But all you'll be actually reporting to me is the number of request movers you're using and what the total costs were. That's all we care about. So here are the three categories and more about what they mean. Request movers is pretty easy. That moves requests around. For consortial borrowing, usually what we're talking about there is you have a virtual merged group catalog. And then you have a system in place by which the patrons and staff of the institutions can then order from any of the others in the group. And then request managers, you know, that's something where through one interface you're managing activity on a bunch of different systems. But again, we're not gonna go item by item, we'll just get a total for each of these categories of system. Let's see. Oh, I mentioned we got data. And I know, I think I've got two sets of data. And I've only really analyzed one. But what a difference that made, because for 15 months we've been talking about this in the abstract. Well, longer if you talk about the working group. And it was really hard to make any sense out of it because everything seemed equally important. It was really hard to separate what really mattered from what didn't. So a good example is, by the way, this is real data. This is from a public institution. They said I could share this, but I'm a little squeamish about telling you who it is. But these are real numbers here. One of the big questions was, what staff do we include? And there was a big debate. Do we include folks who are not part of ILL? A lot of people throughout the library, and sometimes even outside the library, touch an ILL request. So does that matter? Is that worth gathering? And when we had data, you can see really, I don't know how clearly you can see that, but the person in the mailroom, 46% of their time is spent shipping ILL stuff, so that's worth including. And so if you can, you gotta go track that stuff down. Having data also made it kind of a lot easier to set a threshold. Who should not be included? We don't wanna get everybody. We finally figured out if a person doesn't spend 10% of their time, at least, on collection sharing activities, just don't bother including them. Problem with that is you kind of have to do the calculation and figure out if they meet that 10%. But it's amazing the number of people throughout the library who do at least 10% in resource sharing. Let's see. Oh, and I need to remind you again, this stuff will not be reported to me. This looks like really a lot of detailed data, right? Again, all I'm going to see is the totals for each category of staff. So we've got supervisor, we've got full-time, we've got part-time, students, and then casual or volunteer. Those are our categories. We decided not to track whether you have a professional degree or not. Who cares? We're really tracking management costs from the worker costs. And then we've talked about also, just came up in the last week with the beta group, possibly having a breakdown between those who are 100% in ILL and those who are in other departments. That might be an interesting breakdown as well. So here's a mock-up of what a report might look like if we had reports. So far, the database isn't actually built, and the reports aren't fully designed, but this is kind of what you would see after you put your data in. You wanted to look at what your unit costs. This is an example for lending. And again, it's ugly, and there's some colors that need to be changed, and I've already moved some things around here. But this is a general idea of how it would break down. And again, the numbers are actually real. You can see one of the things that sticks out for me right away is the systems that you use make up an incredibly small percentage of your overall costs. Because I usually think of that as, I bet that's a big ticket item, you know? It's really not. It's a tiny percentage. And look at staff. Staff is always a big chunk. And that's even for things like consortial borrowing where you have highly automated processes. So that's kind of an interesting thing that jumps out right away. And then down here you can see actual unit costs for this institution spread across the different collection sharing activities for lending. And then the bottom line are the unit costs adjusted for the borrowing and lending fees. So you can get a real clear idea of what that, what effects, like if you're charging, you can see what effect that has on your unit costs and how much you're making up. And you may even decide to adjust your charging based on those figures. This is a mock-up of what a report might look like if you're comparing with peer institutions. And then the little box there, those criteria, they're kind of made up too. They're close to being finalized, and it'll probably be something like that. We're even thinking of adding some other ones, so we're still working on that, but close to being fixed. And it's a fantasy that there'd be 12 libraries that have data. Right now, like I said, I've got two, but 12 should be a low number. I'm hoping we have 1,200. We'll see what we can get. That's a dream of mine. And then this is a pretty good indication of the level of detail the reports will probably go into. If you're going to go all this trouble to gather the data, you're going to want to see it broken out into different categories. And in fact, this isn't even detailed enough. I did this really quickly when I first was analyzing that first set of data. And I realized, looking at it, I really need to break staff, equipment, and shipping out by category for this to be really useful. So again, these are everything in the white columns are real numbers, and everything in the blue was just made up because I don't have anything to compare it with yet. But this will be kind of what those reports look like. So here's the time frame for what we're doing. And you know, I've used the slide before, and every time I use it, it gets closer to being the truth. We're really close. So what I hope is by ALA midwinter, we're actually done with the beta testing. We've got the database built. They've tested the reports. By ALA annual, I mean, in Chicago. By that time, I'm hoping to open it up to early adopters, anybody who wants to go next. So the betas really took their lumps and worked hard. The next group should have a little bit of a smoother ride, I hope. So if this is you, if you'd like to be part of this, let me know. And I will be putting out announcements on the various resource sharing listservs to ask folks if they want to sign up. Eventually, it'll be open for everybody. This is going to be a free thing that lives on the web. But I'm, you know, like any kind of cost study, it's going to be work. Gathering the data and getting it together is a lot of work, I have to admit. But hopefully the benefit will make it worthwhile. And there's a tiny URL there. It's not even that tiny. It's kind of long for a tiny URL, actually. But that's where you can get some more background information on the project. So we do have some future challenges to keep this going and sustain it. We're going to have to keep working on it. It's going to be a kind of a long-term project, I think. And the environment keeps changing. We're going to have to evolve to keep up with it. We still, you know, we want to make sure it works for non-U.S. libraries, and it's really going to be trying to get people to commit to the time it's going to take to gather this and put it in. It's going to be a challenge, and so hopefully we can work with different groups to have top-down kind of, if directors and stuff think this is good, people will do it, because it is a little bit of a commitment of time. And to circle back around to what's in it for you, I can answer that now, I think. If you're an ILL or if ILL reports to you, it's really clear you're going to get some strategic intelligence out of this. You're going to have some hard data that'll help you evaluate the way your resource sharing operations are running. You can make some decisions, and you can see how others are doing too. You can see where you fit in. So that's good. For OCLC, this has been a wonderful opportunity to engage really deeply with members of the community to address this problem that existed. It's a problem it's a gap in our knowledge out there, and to be able to work with experts in the community to solve that, and in the end have this tool that comes out of it, that's pretty great. That's a win for everybody. And what about if you're not in ILL, and ILL doesn't even interest you, and you don't care about ILL costs? What's in it for you? Well, I've got an answer to that one too. And that is, no matter what you're doing, what your job is, there must be a piece of data or a tool. If you just had that, it would make your life easier. So if you're thinking about something like that, let us know. This is the kind of conversations we like to have. Maybe we can help. We can kick the idea around and pick each other's brains and see if there's a solution. Not every one of those conversations leads to a project or a tool, but every project starts with an idea. And very often the idea is one of yours. So please let us know. That's what I've got. Thanks.
Thanks, Dennis. Good morning. I'm Sharon Streams. I'm the director of the WebJunction program. And just very briefly, for those who may not be familiar, WebJunction focuses on learning, in particular, how it applies to library practice. And our belief is that learning isn't learning until it's applied. But what I'm going to talk to you today is about our current project involving Wikipedia and public libraries. And OCLC was one of five winners of the Knight Foundation's 2016 News Challenge for Libraries. For our answer to their question, how can libraries serve 21st century information needs? And our thought was, information professionals are keenly aware of how critical information literacy is today, with the speed and ease by which information can be, or content can be created, shared, consumed on the web with seemingly no filter. And Wikipedia is a ubiquitous presence in the information landscape and honestly could be part of the problem or part of the solution. And we thought that librarians could really play a role in which way that goes. So I just want to do a little quick poll is, how many people have used Wikipedia as an information source? Hands up. Okay. How many have looked at the edit or talk page of a Wikipedia page? Good, good. How many have edited a page themselves? Nice. Okay, how many have interact with library users who are using Wikipedia as an information source? Okay, and how many of you view overall Wikipedia as a credible information source? Okay. Very good tool. Wikipedia is immensely popular. We know that. It's the sixth most visited website in the U.S. and fifth globally. It sticks about that in Alexa rankings pretty consistently. It attracts up to 15% of internet traffic every day. Wikipedia was launched in 2001 of January. It just hit its 16th anniversary this week. Its vision is a resource that provides every person free access to knowledge in their own language. And already, I think we're seeing some alignment with the vision of libraries as well there. We've had hundreds and thousands of people from around the world to build and maintain the content. It currently includes over 40 million articles in more than 250 languages. And there's a cadre of volunteer Wikipedians who have established and maintain protocols and processes to try to keep the information credible, as well as free and open, and it, of course, relies on public donations to make this possible. But Wikipedia actually operates largely disconnected from the wealth of resources and expertise that exist in libraries. And of course, it's an open as it is, but it's still on the web, and that does not connect to those who have no internet access. Also, we are aware that a Wikipedian culture is represents a narrow demographic of society at large, for example, overwhelmingly male. But we can't underestimate the impact of Wikipedia. It's not only used by students writing papers or for settling bar bets about the discography of Frank Zappa. Here's an interesting example. We've got, according to the IMLS Institute for Healthcare Informatics, Wikipedia is the top source of healthcare information for both patients and doctors. 50% of physicians use Wikipedia for information, especially for specific conditions. Why is that? It's convenient. No paid subscription, no login. It's easy to access from any computer or device connected to the internet. So rather than resist this trend, the medical community has decided to embrace it and have focused on improving the content on medical-related Wikipedia pages. But indeed, Wikipedia is open for improvement. If you know where to look on a Wikipedia page, and those who are raising your hand in my informal poll know this, that there are cues on each page that, from the perspective of the Wikipedians, are desperate cries of help to improve the content, but are largely overlooked by the vast majority of us. But when we learn to see these calls for action and understand how we can help, then we get how library expertise and connections to authoritative sources can improve Wikipedia and extend the synthesis and dissemination of knowledge. Being able to discern between credible and non-credible resources is a critical skill for information seekers. Wikipedia, we maintain, could be used as a teaching tool for discussing and teaching information literacy, both in terms of what it does well and how it can be improved. Wikipedians refer to a specific definition of what a reliable source is based on the type, the creator, and publisher of a work. However, Wikipedia editors often overlook the library as a place to
for source of credible resources, especially that those are who not easily find that those are not easily findable through a Google search. You might not have known, I think actually probably a lot of these in the room do, that Wikipedia articles have a peer review process, and that is order to reach the cherished featured article status. They must meet standards for both quality and importance. But Wikipedians also recognize that most articles fall short of this standard, so relatively few articles have achieved feature article status. There are well over 200,000 articles with no citations at all. But this highlights a really important Wikipedian culture, something that I've really have a very recent aha about, and that's this idea of the work in progress of Wikipedia. And unlike traditional publishing, and I come from a traditional publishing background, the content is available to the world from its inception, and you can see it's all visible, the process moving it from stub to starter to work in progress to featured article, including you see all the commentary and all of the work that's been done along the way to shape that. That's still quite an uncommon practice overall, so users and information professionals, we need to be able to discern the difference about where the content is along that continuum and make decisions accordingly about how we will use the information. Okay, public libraries. Well, we know that they exist in every U.S. community virtually and steward, of course, a wide range of credible source material and local information. They're also that essential bridge to those stranded by the digital divide. Librarians would like to see users move beyond Wikipedia, not just start and stop their research on Wikipedia to fulfill their information needs, and including using local library resources. But presence, the visibility of Wikipedia on the web, libraries have a relatively low visibility on the web. I've just pulled the Alexa rankings earlier this month that shows you what it is for the British Library and the Library of Congress alongside the single-digit numbers for Wikipedia. But our project is testing the supposition that with similar missions, values, and goals, as well as complementary strength and needs, that closer collaboration between libraries and Wikipedia will be mutually beneficial. So what is our project? We just started, we just kicked off last month, and we're just digging into right now. And the first phase is to build awareness. So just even my little brief pitch that I did of giving you some information about Wikipedia, that's an example of that. We're just kind of raising awareness about why it may be worth libraries' time and attention and how libraries can get involved. We're currently in the process of selecting a Wikipedian in residence to work with us for the duration of the project. We'll be offering an online training program for 500 public library staff from across the U.S. Then, with guidance from our Wikipedian in residence and our own project staff and our subject matter expert at OCLC Research, Marilee Prophet, we'll be then following some of the libraries as they conduct local programming or otherwise introduce what they've learned from the training into their libraries. And finally, from that, we'll create some case studies that give some examples about how the programming went and how community members and library staff are engaging with Wikipedia as a result. We hope that this experience will benefit the entire community. We're starting with public libraries, but we do think it will be transferable knowledge and resources to all library types. So what are the results that we hope to see or will be exploring, will be tracking as we do this, watch this matchmaking occur? One is that we hope that Wikipedians will better understand how their local public library can enrich their work. Also, that libraries and their resources will be more visible on Wikipedia, and particularly through the citations section of articles. and that librarians will be better equipped to help information seekers make the best use of Wikipedia. But there's also a real human-to-human element here. Wikipedia has a very strong culture, and librarians do too. We know that we want to build some cultural awareness across, and that will be learning each other's styles, work styles, mores, values. As I said at the outset, I think there's very complementary missions and values, but how they're executed are pretty different in some respects. So let's build some understanding between the two so that there can be a possibility for advocacy happening across both ways. And it's really around that shared goal to protect access, free and open access to knowledge. We also hope to see libraries offer new programs that guide community members to become Wikipedia editors in their own right and thus inject new and more diverse perspectives into Wikipedia. And under the guidance of librarians who understand how to create high-quality articles and new connections to the Wikipedian community, Wikipedia should be improved as an information source. So as I mentioned at the top, that the project is funded in part by the Knight Foundation, but we also just recently received a supplemental grant from the Wikimedia Foundation, in particular to support the Wikipedian in residence position. So it's been exciting to have. We'll be working more directly with the foundation staff. We also have advisors from the Wikimedia DC and New York City chapters and the Wikipedia libraries. Both those DC and New York City chapters have a long and strong track record of engaging libraries, archives, and museum professionals locally. So we are really glad to draw on their expertise. And also, as I mentioned, Marilee Proffitt has been working with Wikipedia over the past 6 years, so we are drawing on her experience as well. And the training will be delivered through the online learning platform of WebJunction, and that is so library staff have the opportunity, since they'll be scattered across the country, to learn from each other and interact with each other as they're going through this process. So there's ways you can follow along with the project. One is you can sign up for monthly updates, and at that little URL, still maybe medium-sized URL there. And there's also a Twitter hashtag that you can follow. I also wanted to mention the One Lib, One Ref, or One Lib, One Ref, depending on your regional your regional preference. So that's happening. That started, kicked off January 15th, coinciding with Wikipedia's anniversary. It goes through tomorrow, I believe. And that's an effort to get as many of us as possible to contribute to strengthen the citations in Wikipedia. If each librarian added one reliable source to one Wikipedia page, then it's going to lift the whole resource overall. If you if you've done that already and you haven't already, you can stop by the OCLC booth in the exhibit hall before it closes and grab a sticker. Roy's holding up a representative example. It's super jazzy monotone in black and white.
All the best ALA attendees have them, okay?
Yeah, and then for the selfie inclined, take a selfie, post it, use the hashtag. You will make a lot of Wikipedians out there really excited to see that activity. So that's it. Thank you.
As one of those non-public librarians, do you have a timeline in mind for when you're going to roll this out to potential other libraries?
Well, is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. So we will have the resources that we create will all be publicly available to use. So at least for you know, perusing and self-directed learning, how we would structure something, you know, more formal training program, that would be TBD. based on, you know, resources, funding with that. But so I think that would be a strong follow-on for it. This project goes through May 2018. So I would say in 2018 is when we would have early 2018, we have a clearer view of the next steps in a formal project sense.
Okay. Thank you.
I think this is for Roy. As OCLC has worked with works and linked data and the ability to disaggregate and then re-aggregate pieces of data that work well together, it raises questions about the human effort that goes into building authorized access points. Is there, how much need do you see for continued use of constructed, human-constructed authorized access points, especially for works? If we had an identifier associated with linked data, would we need to actually build a pre-constructed string?
I'm not sure I'm the right person to answer that question. I think I'd probably kick that to someone else with more knowledge about that. But my opinion in general is that the URI is the important part of that. So if you have that, then I'm not sure how much work needs to go into constructing the string, which is not the machine actionable part. But that's just off the cuff opinion. I'd suggest talking to Karen and others about that.
This is for Roy, too.
Oh, boy.
sorry. I wonder if you could speculate, you might not be willing to do this, but speculate when OCLC cataloging members will be cataloging in a format other than MARC. How long will that take? Right now we're going to be mapping from MARC to schema, for instance. When are we going to flip?
Yeah, that keeps me up at night. In fact, I've written about it as the big flip. And I don't know when it's going to come, but it's not going to come soon. The Library of Congress is, in an experimental way, creating BibFrame from scratch. But they're also creating a parallel MARC record as well. So that's how early days it is. Now, having said that, you know, they've contracted with Index Data to create software to support the creation and migration of MARC to BibFrame and creation of BibFrame records. So it's going to be out there. And so then you have to figure out, okay, when is it going to be the time when we're actually creating this and not creating MARC? And that's way out there, because all of our systems run on MARC. So until the vendors change their systems to run on linked data, most libraries are not going to be doing it from scratch. However, you know, if you're getting your metadata from us, at some point we've already done it. We've already, you know, on an experimental basis, converted all of our data to BibFrame. That was BibFrame 1.0. But you're not going to be necessarily having to do it from scratch. Like, you don't do it a lot of now. I mean, you do some of it for your local stuff, but a lot of the data you get from us. So at some point, we'll have all that available for you to input into your new system that is linked data ready. This is going to take a long time, folks. I'll probably be retired before it happens. So.
Regarding the linked data in WorldCat, has OCLC looked into exposing the holding libraries and the geolocation of those holding libraries as part of that linked data in WorldCat? Because it seems like, you know, we have that information, you know, which libraries are have holdings on which OCLC numbers and the address of those libraries in the WorldCat registry. So it just seems like that might be something that might really help boost those search results in a search engine.
Yeah, that's a good question. As far as I know, we haven't really considered that, but I can take that back.
Great. We're doing it on one of our research projects, but it's not meant to be
Yeah, Karen's mentioned that we're doing it for one of our research projects, but it's not meant to be across the board for all of the WorldCat. This better not be for me. No.
It is, but I just wanted a little bit more information about your idea of discoverability versus description. That's an intriguing idea, and where would I find more information?
My primary example, well, first of all, you can Google data design for discovery and probably find one of my presentations out there. But one of the big examples I use of this is what I've called in the past the Hamlet problem. And this is the problem where, you know, a student comes into your university library or college library and they have a paper due, and of course it's due tomorrow, we all know that. They put in a search for Hamlet because they have to write a paper on that. And what do they get back? They get back screens and screens of results of individual records of different manifestations of that work. And we have no way presently to stitch that together in any useful way through a user interface. With linked data and the concept of a work, we now have the ability to start to do that. So if you can imagine going in and putting in a search for Hamlet, you get one hit back, and then when you click on that, you're able to drill down into the whether you want the movie, whether you want the play itself, where you know whatever. We have mechanisms then to enable the user to more easily discover what they really want, and then of course, then they can continue on from there if they want and link into other kinds of things, criticism or whatever, because we can make those links with your actionable URIs. So that's just one example of how I think data designed for discovery is a very different animal than data designed for description.
We have time for one more question. Right.
Looks like I won.
Awesome. You get to buy the drinks, Roy. Thank you so much for coming. We really appreciate your attention, and look for us on the web, and I hope we see you soon. Bye.